Hi, I'm Colleen Cosmo Murphy, and welcome to another edition of My Classic Album, a series of Classic Album Sunday streams that dig deep into the stories behind our favorite albums created with the support of Arts Council England. A few weeks ago, on the 10th of January, 2021, we marked the fifth anniversary of David Bowie's passing. It has been 5 years since the icon released his final studio album, Black Star, an album he recorded whilst diagnosed with cancer, released on his 69th birthday on January 8th, 2016. He concealed messages of his impending death within Black Star's songs and videos, and 2 days after the album's release, these messages were revealed when Bowie's life on Earth ended. Fans like myself really grappled with Bowie's death. His passing had a surprising impact upon us, as he meant so much more to us than the sum of his musical parts. Throughout his various personas and his life and his music, Bowie inspired those of us that didn't quite fit in, the marginalized misfits like myself, to have the confidence to be who we were, even if we didn't fully subscribe to society's norms. This is why David Bowie still has such a profound hold on us. On this edition of My Classic Album, we're going to take an in-depth look at one of my favorite Bowie albums, an album in which I would argue he first successfully embraced the album format. He had had a hit single with Space Oddity, and his third LP, The Man Who Sold the World, featured many great moments. But I feel it was Hunky Dory that cemented Bowie's position as a major presence in the rock pop world. Joining me to tell the story behind Bowie's 1971 album, celebrating its 50th anniversary this year, is the album's producer, Ken Scott. Now, Ken is something of a legend himself, having learned the tools of the trade at Abbey Road, working with producers like George Martin and little acts like the Beatles. After engineering synths on the Beatles' White Album and Magical Mystery Tour, George Harrison's All Things Must Pass, and David Bowie's The Man Who Sold the World, it was time for Ken to sit in the producer seat himself. And what an album to embark upon in his new role as producer. Hi, Ken. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Colleen. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure. It's always a pleasure speaking with you about music and your
Same here.
career.
Same here.
Now, were you aware of Bowie's music before you started working with him in the studio?
Well, obviously, Space Oddity. That I had left Abbey Road and moved to a studio called Trident, which was at the time it was an up-and-coming independent studio, and I'd been there a couple of times before because the Beatles did some recording there, and I went to listen and see, and I loved the place. That it had a totally different feel from Abbey Road. Abbey Road was always very sort of starched shirt. You had to wear a tie, you had to wear a suit, whereas Trident was much more laid back. And when it came time for me to leave Abbey Road, that was the first place that came to mind. And I must have been there maybe a week, 2 weeks. And one, I went in on a Monday, and I'd listened to what had been recorded on the Saturday by one of the owners, a guy called Barry Sheffield. And it was this young artist called David Bowie, and it was Space Oddity, and was absolutely blown away by it. Then I and another one of the engineers there, Malcolm Toft, were put on recording the album that went with Space Oddity, which was completely different from that particular track. And then from there, I went on to Man Who Sold the World. So yeah, I knew of David. I really liked David. I knew that he had a certain amount of talent. But that he would ever be a superstar? No, not in a month of Sundays, never, no.
So you weren't a fan of The Man Who Sold the World?
Oh no, I liked it. But that was basically it. I liked it. Yeah, that was it.
So how did he come to produce Hunky Dory? How did that story go?
I had reached a point that a lot of recording engineers get to, where you're sitting in the engineer's seat, and you've got the producer by the side of you and the act out in the studio. And at some point you have this idea of a more artistic thing. And you say to the producer, you know what would be great under this guitar solo? And he says, what do you think? I said, I think a herd of trumpeting elephants. And he looks at me and, okay, well, we'll give it a try. And we bring in the herd of trumpeting elephants. We record it, send them out. Now, if it worked, it was the producer's idea. If it didn't work, oh, it was only Ken's idea. I didn't think it would work, but I thought we should try it. And eventually, as a recording engineer, you get fed up with that. Most of us do. And I just made the decision. I wanted to move into production. I wanted them to be my idea, sink or swim kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And I was put on a session with David as producer. He was producing a friend of his. During one of the tea breaks, I happened to say to David about wanting to move into production. And he said to me that he just signed a new management deal and they wanted to put him into the studio to record an album so that they could then shop the deal. He said he had planned to produce it himself. He didn't know if he was capable of doing that. Would I co-produce it with him? And so there's me. Look, the first session I'm ever an assistant engineer on was the biggest band in the world, the Beatles. The first session I ever engineer, sit behind the mixing console and push up the faders, not knowing what the hell I was doing. Once again, it was the biggest band in the world, the Beatles. So I'd always been sort of thrown into the fire each time. And I thought, finally, I can make mistakes without anyone ever hearing them, because there's this guy that I really like working with and he has a certain amount of talent, but no one's ever going to hear the album. So I can mess up if I... Yeah, right. But it wasn't until a couple of weeks later, David, his wife Angie, and his publisher Bob Grace came around to my house and we were going through demos for the songs we were going to do on Hunky Dory. And it must have taken two songs and suddenly I realised that there was much more to him than I originally thought, and that this could be huge and people could start hearing any mistakes I made. So I was petrified again.
So what were those demos like? Were they mainly based on the piano and him singing, and what were the songs like? Do you remember which songs were on those demos?
I honestly can't remember. Mm-hmm. It's we're talking over, that's over 50 years. So, I just remember being suitably impressed. It's interesting the way memory works. I recently, a couple of weeks ago, got to do something like this for a Dublin Bowie festival. Mm-hmm. And it was Rick Wakeman and myself being interviewed. We hadn't spoken with each other for 40 years. And it was interesting, the different memories, because he remembers David playing him the demo of Life on Mars on acoustic guitar. And David said to Rick, I want this to be more piano oriented, but I've got a demo of Life on Mars that David did at home and it's all on piano.
Oh, interesting. We
all remember things slightly differently. So if we remember them at all, that's it.
Well, you do remember a lot, Ken, because you took care of yourself. Let's put it that way. But one thing that I have read is that Oh You Pretty Things is one of the first things you wrote for the album. And of course, it was released as a single by Peter Noon of Herman's Hermits, who released his first solo album, his first solo single in May, right before you started recording the album, and it was already a hit.
If I might interrupt for a second, that's one of the things that Rick and I agreed on. We both thought that we had recorded it before the Peter Noon version came out.
Okay. How did David feel about that version being a hit? It was his own song, so he must have been happy to get the publishing, but how did he feel about that version coming out before his own?
He gave it to him. So that was the way it went. He was at a point where he felt comfortable within it. He had to prove a point. Mm-hmm. He had success with Space Oddity with Gus Dudgeon producing. And Gus is one of the producers I learned from. He was very much like George Martin was. And that's very much the talent is put into the studio to do one thing, and that is to create. And as a producer, you have to allow that talent to create. Give them the freedom. And that's what Gus did with David on Space Oddity. Space Oddity is very, very close to the original demo that, that David did at home. The other things that David did, I felt Tony Visconti was, it was more his record than it was David's. David wrote the songs and sang, but the arrangements, bass playing and all of that was Tony. He had more control. And I think David had to prove a point and show that he knew what would be successful for him. Mm. And I think we, the first part of that was writing a hit song, which he did with that song, and continued with, on with Hunky Dory. And it, it proved the point. He did know how best to show himself.
Well, obviously the songs themselves are quite strong. I mean, every single song on this album on Hunky Dory is a strong song, as opposed to The Man Who Sold the World, which I feel personally there's only a few songs that are really that strong.
Yeah.
But did David have an idea of how he wanted the album to actually sound when you went into the studio?
I didn't. The fact that he asked me to co-produce it with him, having worked with him before and knowing what I'd done before, it was at the point, I think he just asked me to do it because he knew I would get the sound that he was after. We never actually discussed what it would sound like. I just went ahead and did what I wanted to do. And it was fine.
Because to me, you had just done George Harrison, All Things Must Pass. When I listen to Hunky Dory, I do hear a driving kind of folky acoustic sound.
It's interesting because I've often sort of thought about the use of acoustic guitar on Ziggy, because that's much more of a rock album, but we used acoustic guitar on that on almost every track. And sorry, I just realized that my power cord came out. Okay, there we go. There was a certain amount of crossover between All Things Must Pass and Hunky Dory with the acoustic thing. The main one for me where that really comes across is Quicksand, because we recorded the basic track. David played acoustic when we did it. And as soon as we'd finished, I said, okay, I now want to record. I want you to play it four more times on acoustic guitar. Because I just, as we were going through, I just had this idea of how I wanted the acoustic to sort of grow at parts and then go back to a single one, just various parts up until everyone else comes in. I wanted to be a very moving part of the thing in the stereo point of view, which came, I guess, from the acoustics on All Things Must Pass.
Well, that's such a very deep song. You know, it has references to Nietzsche and the occult, Aleister Crowley, the Golden Dawn. And Bowie later said it was a mixture of narrative and surrealism, and a precursor actually to his 1977 LP Low. But Hunky Dory couldn't sound any different than to Low. And you know, you were using a new 16 track desk as well over at Trident. So did you feel like you had a lot of kind of all the tools you needed to really express the creativity he was looking for?
Well, one just always had to keep one step ahead of him, because you never, I think all of us had a basic outline of what the track was going to be like. But David could suddenly say, oh, I want to put the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra on this. And you had to make sure you had room to record the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra if he suddenly came up with that. So you always had to try and be one step ahead of him. But it, look, technically, we were still, I was going to say backwards, but I don't feel it was backwards. We had far less then than there is available today. And in many respects, I think that made it a lot easier, because you made decisions. Instantly, you had to, because you didn't have the 199 tracks you might need to record everything. We had only 16, and we worked with it. And I think it turned out okay.
Yeah, I think it turned out about pretty decent. Yeah,
I don't
pretty
know
good.
that it would be any better if we had 199 tracks and 1,000 plugins to put on every track.
Right, exactly. Now David himself was quite good at hearing how a song would sound arranged and like if, by throwing in different elements that you thought may not work. He had an ear to hear how it would sound all put together, correct?
Sometimes there were ideas that he would try that we wouldn't use. So you only ever actually get to hear the ones that did work, much like it was with the Beatles. But he certainly had ideas. But one of the things for me with regard to David was he was so good at picking the team to put across what he was after at any given point. The team of Woody Woodmansey, Trevor Boulder, Mick Ronson, on that album, Rick Wakeman, and then myself, I think it was the perfect team for putting that across. Cut it back by one, got rid of Rick Wakeman for Ziggy, and it just carried on. And then when he wanted to change, he found a completely new team. Mm-hmm. And the whole American thing, he wanted to sound American. So what do? You put together an American team because no British group would sound the same. And he was so good at picking that. And he would just play you the song and then let you go. He had picked you because he knew what you would do and just allowed you to do it. If he didn't like it, he would say, but more often than not, it was, okay, yeah, we'll move on.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is a good point to talk about the band, actually. There's Mick Ronson, who had played on The Man Who Sold the World, as well as Woody Woodmansey.
Yeah.
Tony Visconti had been on The Man Who Sold the World, had also produced it, but he was on bass, replaced on this album by Trevor Boulder. Now, with Mick and with Woody, was there any tension with David that had come past from the previous album, The Man Who Sold the World?
Not in the slightest, not that I ever noticed. We all just got on fine, had a lot of fun, and came up with the goods.
But David must have been under significant pressure with this album as well, not having a record deal secured prior to recording it.
When we first went in, I think we were both under a lot of pressure. Mm. Because it was the first time for either of us actually going in and producing, apart from his being the act, he'd done that three times before. Mm-hmm. This was the first time of production and coming up with the ideas of what it should be like. And we both walked in. I think we were both very nervous to start with. But as we went on and it started to sound better and better and our ideas were working, it gave us more and more confidence to take it that much further kind of thing.
Gotcha.
So, yeah, a certain amount of pressure on everyone. And he loved putting the pressure onto like Trevor and Woody because he'd shown them the song. First take through, they're going to mess up like mad. Second take through, probably break down or something like that. And then the third one, that had to be the one. Otherwise it was, that one's not working. We'll move on to something else. So there was always that, Woody says, they were always sitting on the edge of their seat, just hoping they'd get through that take because David got very bored in the studio. He didn't like being there particularly. And I think that's, I can understand it perfectly because as far as I'm concerned, he was the best vocalist in the studio, performer in the studio that I've ever worked with. Of the four albums that I co-produced with him, 95% of the vocals were one take beginning to end. And it was that first take. He'd do it once. And what he did that once is what you hear today.
He was a consummate performer.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. It was brilliant. And if you know you can do that, you hope to get at least close to it with the people you're working with. Mm-hmm. So he expected Woody and Trevor and Ronno. We already knew Ronno was like that as well with his guitar playing. But with the other two, he wanted the same kind of thing from them. And so they felt probably more pressure than we did.
Well, let's talk a little bit about Mick Ronson, actually, because I think he was, how integral was he to the recordings?
I'm sorry, say that again?
How integral was Mick Ronson to the recordings? He did a bit more than just play guitar, correct?
Well, he did string arrangements, orchestral arrangements, yeah. Mm-hmm. He was David's right-hand man. I never really thought he got his just dessert, shall we say. I don't think David, as good as he was as a performer, as a writer and everything, I think Ronno was the thing that really brought it together that much more and got him to the point where he became as successful as he did. I don't think, without Ronno, I don't think he would have been as big.
Interesting.
And I could have made the mistakes then that everyone heard, and then it would...
Well, Ronno has a little bit of a cameo at the end of Life on Mars, doesn't he?
A little.
Do you want to tell us about that? I mean, because we hear this, listen to Life on Mars, which is my favorite song on the album. I mean, this is a song that would make me cry, especially when I was listening to it as a teenager. I just loved the lyrics, the surreal, almost cut up sensibility. And they were just so emotionally resonant, even if they didn't really make literal sense, but they just made such emotional sense to me. Tell us a story about that sound that comes in at the end.
Well, that track, just sidetracked just slightly, going off of what you just said, Rick Wakeman has said that that's possibly the best piano part he's ever played in his life. Rick does nothing but rave about the writing of that song, the way David will go to a chord that no one would ever think of going to, kind of thing within that. And it's, as you've seen, I think when I give my full talk, I break down the multi-track of Life on Mars. And so the audience get to actually hear the piano with nothing else going on. And whenever I play that, the hair on the back of my neck stands up. And I've heard it thousands of times now. And still, every time, it's, oh my God, that's incredible.
But did he feel like that when you were actually recording it? Did everybody feel that when that was being recorded in the studio? Was there that kind of emotional atmosphere?
Yeah, I think so. I won't go on. Later, I was just thinking of Aladdin Sane, the piano solo on that Mike Garson played. It was much the same kind of thing. It was, oh my God, that's brilliant.
The one Lady Grinning Soul is just a gorgeous piano solo.
But that's more the kind of thing you expect from that song. Whereas the solo on Aladdin Sane is just all over the place, and it's not something that had ever been heard in rock music before, I don't think. Mm-hmm. I didn't know it. So it had that kind of effect. And it's the piano on Life on Mars certainly moved us. The story of the end. I said a little while ago about we had to make decisions when we were recording then. One of the ways we made decision, me especially, was I didn't like to keep outtakes. So we'd be going, the tape would be rolling, and we'd get a take. If it wasn't the one, I'd roll back to the beginning of the tape and start recording again. So I was always recording over what we'd done. So we did probably one take, one complete take, and then a bit of a break there. They started and something happened during that second take. Mm-hmm. When I then rolled the tape back, we did another take, and that was the one. So we started to overdub the things on it. And the final thing we put on it was the strings. And the strings at the very end were just sustaining. And I had to fade them out at the end. And as they're sustaining, we suddenly hear this bit of piano come back in. And we realized it was the breakdown that had happened on that earlier take. And what it was right next to the piano, there was a public phone. And someone had got a wrong
good
number
place for it.
Well, it was in a bathroom off the side of there.
Even so better.
It was there basically for the session musicians to be able to call up. Do I have a session this afternoon? Okay, yeah, right. And tell somewhere to go. No one knew the number. It just happened to be a wrong number. And it came right in the middle of this really great take. And I had to stop it. And Mick Ronson was, what? That was great. What's going on, kind of thing. And I just said, listen, and he heard the phone going and he used some foul language. Let me just put it that way. Okay. And so when we heard this come in under the strings fading out, we had to use it. Only I just had to fade it out really quickly so you couldn't hear what Ronno was saying because we wanted it to be played by the BBC and they would never have played that then. So that's basically the story behind it.
Now, I mean, it seems like Bowie was a little bit obsessed with the planet Mars, but I read that at the time, I guess there was a whole frenzy in the media with the US and the Soviet Union racing to get to the red planet first. Do you remember any of that surrounding? Okay. I was just wondering, because then you have Ziggy Stardust and the spiders from Mars. So that is like life on Mars, Mars this, Mars that, you know, so it's quite interesting. Also, we should also mention that it was a there's a bit of a parody as well of the Paul Anka penned My Way, because both Bowie and Anka, haven't they both written songs to the same French tune? I think it was called Comme d'habitude, and Anka bought the rights, so Bowie's was never released, so he was a bit upset about that, a bit disgruntled. So there he goes. So he kind of held Mars on the chorus as kind of like a swipe at Sinatra's Choral Beast, his rendition of My Way. Yeah, just kind of funny. Aside from Life on Mars, are there any other songs on the album that you felt were a real joy to record as well?
Changes. That was,
let's talk about changes.
So sort of obviously a great pop song. Mm-hmm. And just the way it was all put together, it just worked perfectly. And then, of course, there was the madness of the last track on the album.
Oh yeah, Beaulieu Brothers.
The laughing gnome coming back in, making his appearance at the very end. But just that whole track, it was the last track that we recorded. We were right towards the end, and David came in and he said, I've got this new song. We've got to record it. I said, fine, okay. He said, it's called the Bewley Brothers. I said, okay. And he said, but don't take any notice of the lyrics. Now, I'm not a lyric person. To me, what's important is the melody. Because I listen to someone singing a song and I will get the lyrics completely wrong every time. So it's what's the point of worrying about it, as far as I'm concerned? So when he said, don't worry about the lyrics, it was that really didn't mean too much to me other than, well, why? Now, remember, this was at the time when America was going mad about Paul is dead. And they were finding every little thing that they could. These DJs would come up with, oh, we just saw a Volkswagen that was parked outside, and that was UR28 or something like that, which would have been how old McCartney was. It's all proof that he was dead. So they're finding all this ridiculous crap as to why Paul was dead. So David just said, the lyrics don't mean anything. I've just written them for the Americans to look as hard as they can and find whatever they want in it. And I must have heard 8-9 different versions of what that song was supposed to be about from other people. And David would have agreed with every single one of them.
I think he did reveal, though, in an interview later in the 70s, that it was at least part of it was indeed about his brother, Terry, who was suffering from mental illness, diagnosis.
Yeah, I think he said a lot of other things as well about it that didn't necessarily go along with that. So,
right. There you go. Well, I wasn't there, Ken. You were.
I can only tell you what he told me. And it just so happened, Bewley Brothers, or at least Bewley's, was a tobacconist. That had a place, Trident Studios was a place called St. Anne's Court, which we were surrounded by apartments, flats that ladies of the night lived in. Okay, we're in the heart of Soho, and this is just off of Wardour Street. Mm-hmm. And down the road, a little ways down Wardour Street, was this tobacconist called the Bewley Brothers or the Bewleys. I'm not sure which it was, but that's how we got the name. It was from this tobacconist.
Oh, interesting. Now, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I understand that Bowie had also been on a promotional radio tour in the States in early 1971. And on Hunky Dory, he really pays tribute to a few American icons, including Bob Dylan, Andy Warhol, Velvet Underground, especially Lou Reed, with whom you later all worked on Transformer, actually not long after this recording this album. Bowie penned a song for Bob Dylan when he was lamenting the lack of a hero in pop music, because I guess this is at the time when the Beatles had broken up, Dylan was in hiding. And of course, Bowie would subsequently remedy this situation when he created his own character, which would ultimately nearly consume him, Ziggy Stardust. But that's the topic of another album at another time.
Yeah.
But with these pop tributes and Ziggy, Bowie was really taking a postmodern stance, commenting upon popular culture from within it. Did you feel at the time that after the breakup of the Beatles and with Dylan basically in hiding, that there really was a lack of a pop icon at that time? I mean, there was Mark Bolan, but he wasn't really the same as someone like the Beatles or Bob Dylan.
Oh, no. I didn't. Mm-hmm. Just look, think of who I'm working with. I'd worked with the Beatles, carried on with George, John and Ringo on solo things. I was working with Elton John. I'd done the America album before Hunky Dory. So it's still this likening it to the success part of there being an icon. I was still working with very, very highly successful Harry Nilsson, who absolutely brilliant, those type of artists. So I never sort of saw that any kind of drop at all. Mm-hmm. But every day was just working for me. I was a complete workaholic. And the studio is my second home. I still love it. I get to be in a control room far less these days, unfortunately. Yeah. But no, it was all about what I was working on at any given time. And that was the center of my universe at that point.
Well, there's a couple other tributes on this album, as I mentioned before, Andy Warhol. Yeah.
He didn't take it as a tribute.
I know he didn't. That's right, because Bowie played it from a few months after the album's released, and he said that Andy just walked out of the room.
Yeah.
he didn't say anything. Yeah. But there's a kind of a funny exchange between you and David on the album about Andy Warhol.
About the pronunciation, yes.
Were you not a Warhol fan?
I still don't know quite whether I say it correctly or not. I don't know which is right. So I guess it's very much the Bowie Bowie thing.
I was going to say,
I get
what
annoyed
is it
when people say David Bowie?
Cause I do Bowie too. It's Bowie, like yes. Joey.
And it was always the Bowie, it was the Bowie knife. It was never the Bowie knife, which was the whole thing. I still don't know what's the correct way of pronouncing it, but I obviously did it incorrectly that one time.
That's really cute. I like that part. It's just
That was on take one. Now, I think the final was take four, but I said about rolling the tape back and going over. We'd done that. We knew we had to keep that beginning to use it. So I would always start the tape again to get to take four after that. And then we just spliced it on when it came time to mix.
Now speaking of Joey or Joey Bowie, he had a son who he named Joey at the time, who's now named Duncan Jones. Around the same time you started recording, and the song Kooks, which is such a gorgeous song, and it's especially as a parent, you really feel that song so much. He had his son Duncan a few days before the recording sessions began, I believe.
Yeah.
Did he talk with you about being a new father?
No. He was very much like me, workaholic. It was the fatherhood came second to everything else.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha.
We both made mistakes in that area. And I think Duncan's told a lot about it and some of the stuff that I saw as well. It's he wasn't the best father then. And I think that's one of the reasons that he seemed to give up for some time. And no one knew what was going on with him. And I think he'd realized his mistakes with Duncan, and he didn't want to make the same mistakes with Lexi. So he just stayed home and was a parent the way he should be.
I think he also tried being in his son's life as well around the Let's Dance.
Later, yes. Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. But no, I don't envy any kid being brought up by David at that point and Angie at any point. But
how much influence did she have over him at that time? Because really it's around this time when you were working with him where he starts to really transform. And, you know, I'm wondering how much, number one, how much influence she had, but also, I mean, what was he like working with him? Because, you know, on his kind of in the press and when he's out there in the world, he's, you know, bending societal norms, his gender bending. He's doing things that might seem a little bit outrageous. But it sounds to me like in the studio, who he was a consummate pro, where this was like two different David Bowies going on, or this, I think there's more than two different David Bowies.
There are so many artists that I've worked with that have that, that stage persona versus the studio persona. Devo were another group like that. They had their persona, which was outside of the studio, that everyone thought they were completely crazy, this whole thing. In the studio was ultimate professionals. And David was exactly the same. It's as far as Angie, she had absolutely no say in the studio whatsoever. No one did. We weren't. His manager, Tony DeVries, would come by maybe three times during the recording of any of the albums I'd worked on, if that. Angie would just pop in. You'd know she was there because she came in loud and then she'd leave. It was very, no one from record companies at any point. It was just us in there working away. And
so no entourage?
No, not at all.
Interesting.
The closest to an entourage would probably have been It Ain't Easy when we did that, because Dana Gillespie came by, who David was very close with. In fact, when originally looking for a deal, Jem Toby company that managed him, they sent out just a record which combined some of David's stuff that we'd recorded and some of Dana Gillespie's stuff which had been recorded, and was trying to get a joint deal for both of them at the same time.
Well, It Ain't Easy didn't make its way onto Hunky Dory, but it did later, which goes to show you, I mean, these two albums, The Rise and Fall of Ziggy Stardust and Hunky Dory, were recorded so closely together. In fact, you were recording The Rise and Fall of Ziggy before Hunky Dory even came out.
Right. Before he even had the deal settled.
Wow.
Because that's what we got, the one album, RCA was interested. They wanted, was it just a one-off? He'd already had one-off single kind of thing. Was this going to be another one of those kind of things? So they wanted to hear more. So we immediately went in, did Ziggy, and that's what finalized the deal with RCA.
It's interesting because it sounds like these two albums were recorded at such separate times, because again, it's just like the song changes. You know, you have this mutability of David Bowie's character, and you know, the song changes, really foreshadowing his future role playing.
But it's interesting because I don't see quite so much of a difference as a lot of people do, because you've got Queen Bitch.
Yes.
That could have fitted on Ziggy easily. Then you've got It Ain't Easy, which was recorded for Hunky Dory, and we didn't use it on that, and that went on to Ziggy. So there is very much a sort of a meeting of the two of them. They're not that different.
They're not that different sonically, but I would say image-wise they are. I mean, if you look at this album, you know, it's very pastoral. This sounds, you know, and of course, you know, Stardust is not a concept album, as we know, but it does have a character that some of the songs sort of allude to.
Yeah.
And he takes on a new character, and it's quite spectacular. You know, it's very different than this kind of Marlena Dietrich inspired cover, you know, album cover as well. In fact, on this album cover, he does adopt the pose of Marlena Dietrich.
But then let's go back one step further. The original cover for Man Who Sold the World.
That's right.
That fits, which is very different from Hunky Dory, but it's very similar type of image on the front, which was him in that dress, lounging very much like Marlena Dietrich with the long blonde hair and everything. And that was a heavy metal album, if you like. And then, he messed about with his image versus musicality quite a lot.
Well, it says even here, it says this album was produced by Ken Scott, assisted by the actor.
Oh, yeah.
But interestingly, it also says remixed by Ken at Trident Studios. What does he mean by remixed?
Well, that's what it used to be, because we were only recording on 16 tracks. Mm. Or it goes back even further. Let's go back to the Beatles when we were working on 4-track. You would be recording bass, drums, guitars, piano, all on one track. So that was mixing. So then when it comes to putting it down to the mono or stereo, you're taking the four tracks and you're remixing, because you're taking some of the stuff that you've already prior to that, that you've mixed and recorded onto a track, and you're putting the other ones with it. So it was considered remixing.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And it was much this, it just, that continued for a little while.
So you weren't doing an extended 12-inch dance remix? No. You didn't have 12 inches at that time. It was a few more years. Yeah. Well, critics did like the album when it came out, but, and one said actually that David was setting trends rather than following them, which is, it was a real compliment. But Hunky Dory initially sold very poorly. It failed to chart. And it was only after the commercial breakthrough of The Rise and Fall of Ziggy Stardust and The Spiders from Mars the following year that Hunky Dory itself became a commercial success, and it ended up peaking at number 3 on the UK albums chart. Retrospectively, of course, it's regarded as one of the masterpieces of his career and the album that really set him on his path to success. Now, you started recording The Rise and Fall of Ziggy Stardust and The Spiders from Mars shortly after this, as we said before, and you're still working with him when Hunky Dory actually came out. Was David disappointed with the response, the commercial response to Hunky Dory?
He never said. Mm. We had this, the relationship, we never really spoke about work. We knew what we had to do, and that was it. There was nothing else. Like with regard to mixing, remixing, as it was put on the first one, David only ever came in, of the four plus albums that I did with him, he only ever came in twice. With regard to the mixes. One was Lady Grinning Soul that you said, and another was something we did which only came out as a bonus track. It was 1984/Dodo, which was the beginning of the Diamond Dogs album. So I would do the mixes. I would then send a copy of the mixes to the management company, and I'd hear back from them, yeah, we love it, it's great. David never ever said a word whether he liked it or not.
Oh, interesting.
So my estimation was, as long as I got to do the next one, he must have liked it.
And well, I guess so that worked. Focused.
That worked for four of them until, as I said, that 1984/Dodo. He, at that point, was looking for the American sound. Mm. When we were mixing it, he kept on reverting back to what I remember was Barry White, but I could be wrong. It was the Philadelphia sound he was interested in.
That Gamble and Huff sound.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So that's when he moved to the American thing. But no, we didn't discuss whether it was successful, whether it was not. We were making records for ourselves. And if it was successful, that was great.
I guess he was just purely focused on making the music at that time and not letting the business side really interfere, or the fashion side interfere with what's going on in the studio at that moment. When you look back over your career, and you've worked with so many illustrious musicians, it goes without saying, how do you feel about your work with Bowie and as Bowie as an artist in comparison to everything else that you've done?
Oh, geez. Right there amongst the top echelon, of course. As I said, probably the best studio performer I've ever worked with. Just one take is just absolutely astounding. It's and that's one of the things I miss about today's records. It's not quite like that, to say the least. No auto tuning, no moving around. He just did it, and that was it. No, way up there. Some of my favorite recordings that I've done as individual tracks with him. And not just with, like, one of my favorite tracks is Walk on the Wild Side, Lou Reed, which was David Runo producing, me engineering. And I just, I can't see any way of improving on that track. That recording. So it's, yeah, he's very, very important. Just for having worked with him, just so amazing to have worked with him. But it gave me a move into a whole new career as a producer kind of thing. And just, no, astounding.
Any final thoughts on the album?
It's good.
I think it's great. And so many musicians said that, you know, witnessing him perform Starman in 1972 on Top of the Pops, it really changed their lives and it inspired them to become artists themselves, which is incredible. I mean,
which is very strange. It's so strange because I don't get that part of it. But then it's because I started with the biggest band in the world and it just carried on from there. So I saw them changing the world. Yeah. And that was more evident to me than suddenly seeing David doing Starman and it having that effect on people. It was something that,
I think the effects almost came out like a decade later. I know Dave Stewart from the Eurythmics has cited Hunky Dory as being one album that inspired both him and Annie Lennox of the Eurythmics. Boy George said it changed his life. This album, Hunky Dory did, which is interesting. And also other artists too, like Katie Tunstall, she cites this album, and Guy Garvey both cite this album, Hunky Dory, as being one of their favorites and being hugely inspirational to their career. So it's an album that keeps on giving, Ken. So thank
you. Hopefully we'll be able to do this at the 60th anniversary.
I know. Well, thank you so much, Ken, again speaking with me and for speaking with us about this incredible album.
My pleasure.
And I also want to thank all of you for joining us for another episode of My Classic Album, our video series that we created with the support of Arts Council England. And you can find out more about Classic Album Sundays, including our virtual meetings and events via our Patreon membership on our Classic Album Sundays website. So now I encourage you to take a moment and experience Hunky Dory uninterrupted and in its entirety for yourself. And try to follow our listening guidelines, which is turn off your phone, turn down the lights, turn up the volume, refrain from conversation and multitasking, close your eyes, kick back, and give yourself over to the music. Thanks for listening.